Picking up 1 Timothy chapter 4, let's just jump right in at verse 1. Paul writes, "Now the Spirit," the Holy Spirit of course, "expressly says that in latter times some will depart from the faith, giving heed to deceiving spirits and doctrines of demons, speaking lies and hypocrisy, having their own conscience seared with a hot iron." It's important once more to remind ourselves that the chapter divisions we read in the Bible were placed centuries later by the church for reference purposes and are not part of the original writing. And so sometimes, as today, it looks like we have a hard transition from the end of chapter 3 into new material in chapter 4. But of course, the letter would have been written straight through. And in this case, we really should see a connection. That word translated "now" is a much more subtle word than it might seem in English. And it is a connecting word, a very soft connection that brings the end of chapter 3 to the beginning of chapter 4. And of course, what did we see at the end of chapter 3? Well, we saw the reference to the church of the living God, the pillar and ground of the truth. And in contrast to the truth, we see falsehood in these coming verses. It can be a little confusing when we read "in the latter times," the latter days. But it's an interesting observation to note in the New Testament that the so-called last days actually began the first day of the church. In Acts chapter 2, on the day of Pentecost, as the early apostles and disciples were praising God in other languages and the crowds around, you know, thought they were drunk or something, and Peter stood up and says, "No, this is a fulfillment of prophecy. The prophet Joel said in the last days God would pour out his Spirit." And so Peter equates the first day of the church to the last days. Now, we have a trouble kind of putting that together because we think from our human perspective. We think, boy, the church has been around for almost 2,000 years. You know, what possible meaning could the expression "last days" have if it encompasses 2,000 years? Because we think in terms of that last year or 6 months or whatever before Jesus comes back. But if we look at it from God's perspective, it'll make more sense. Because what we are living in, this time, this dispensation that we could call the church age, is in fact the last dispensation until the return of Jesus Christ. Amen? So from God's perspective, we see the idea of last days making sense. Now, we look at the totality of history, we realize before the church was birthed there at Acts chapter 2 and Pentecost, we had God working through the nation of Israel, subject to the law of Moses. And that, of course, was the case for centuries. But life didn't begin with Moses, did it? You know, before Moses came on the scene and God gave the law through Moses, God was working through the patriarchs, Abraham, Isaac, Jacob, you know, Joseph, and for centuries there were generations there before Moses, and God was active in their lives. And it didn't just start with Abraham being called out of Ur of the Chaldees. Before Abraham, God was at work in this world, and we think of people like Noah and Job, and we could go all the way back to the very beginning, couldn't we, in the garden with Adam and Eve, both when first created and before they fell into sin, and then the consequences afterwards. So God's been at work in different ways throughout the ages. But right now, as he is at work through the church in this world, it is appropriate to see this time period as the last days. So having said that, looking back at what Paul is writing to Timothy, we don't necessarily want to read this as simply a prophecy that was far future from Paul and Timothy's time. It's not like Paul's telling Timothy, "Timothy, let me give you an insight. what the Christians in Elsinore and places around there are going to be going through, what the world's going to look like. No, he's actually talking about the present time for him and Timothy. And what was happening with some of the false teachings there in the church and all, and saying, you know, Timothy, this shouldn't shock us. We shouldn't be surprised that this is taking place. The Spirit has warned us of these things. And of course, it'll only continue on and expand in greater depths. And what does Paul call the false teachings? He calls them the teachings of demons. You know, talk about being politically incorrect. But if you want an interesting homework assignment for this week, determine to read through the Gospel of John and pay attention every time you see the word truth. You'll notice most of the times it's coming from the lips of Jesus. And you see, that's the issue. And that's why I said, going back to the end of chapter 3, where we saw the reference to truth. Because God's word is true. What God has said is the truth. Therefore, anything that teaches something contradictory to what God has clearly taught is false. Now, we're not talking about the white blank spaces between the verses, right? There's a lot of silence, and people say, where's the chapter and verse on that issue or that point? And there isn't one, and there's freedom in the silence. But we're talking about where God has spoken clearly in His Word, the truth. And others are speaking otherwise. Well, they're speaking lies. Who's the father of lies but Satan himself? So what's the source of those teachings that are ungodly but deceiving spirits and the doctrines of demons? Now, we recognize that the word liar is a strong word. It's an insulting word, although it can be a descriptive word if the shoe fits. But to call someone a liar is to say that, buddy, you know what the truth is, and you're deliberately saying something else. You're a liar. But there's a lot of people who are very sincere, and they think that what they believe is true. So you wouldn't want to call them liars, because that's not where they're coming from. But the reality is, they're speaking lies. Because if it's not the truth of God's word, it goes against what God said. It is false. Speaking lies. But Paul adds here, speaking lies in hypocrisy. And that's an interesting addition there. That word hypocrisy derives, going back to those days in Greek, to speak to an actor. You know, they had Greek theater back in ancient days. And the actors in Greek theater typically performed holding up a mask in front of their face. Maybe you're familiar with some of this. And on the mask would be painted the emotion of whatever was going forth. There was comedy. There was tragedy. And so a Greek actor, more literally, is one who wears a mask. And that's where the word hypocrite has come into our language. And that's the appropriate understanding of hypocrite. You see, in the way that our society reinterprets words, we've come to a point where if, for example, a parent who did a lot of ungodly, stupid things as a teenager, and now knows how wrong that behavior was, it tries to express to a child, don't do those things, the parent's not being a hypocrite. If that was the meaning of the word, then no one could ever share Jesus Christ with anybody else. The Apostle Paul would be the biggest hypocrite in history, because he was opposed to the Christian faith. He was born again, and then he proclaimed Jesus. So if you're an atheist and you get saved, you become a born-again Christian, what, you can't ever tell anyone that atheism is wrong? That they need to trust Jesus Christ without being labeled hypocrite? Of course, see, that's foolish. That's not what the word means. But one who wears a mask brings it home. Because if you're telling someone this is how you ought to live, and you are living otherwise, you're a hypocrite. That's the true meaning of the word. You're a phony. You're a fake. And I think one of the best modern examples I can think of speaking lies and hypocrisy are those who have beliefs, attitudes, whatever. They go against the truth of God's word and then speak of tolerance, that we all have to be tolerant to one another. Now, I'm all for being tolerant in the traditional understanding of the word. And the traditional understanding of the word was kind of that live and let live philosophy. Look, it's your life. Who am I to tell you how you ought to live? You know, you're not hurting anybody and all those kind of things. But you're wrong. And I believe that you're wrong. That's how tolerance used to be. But God bless you. You know, I'm not going to have you arrested or anything. I mean, but you're wrong. And you need to change. You need to repent of what you believe and how you're living. Today, tolerance has been redefined to say it's not just about having different opinions. You have to affirm that everybody is right and nobody is wrong. Because as long as they believe that, they should be affirmed. You have a right to believe whatever you want, but you don't have a right to say that your false belief is actually true. And the way it's come into hypocrisy, and why I use this as an example, is because the people who are the most vocal about being tolerant under the new definition are the most intolerant towards Christians who stand on the truth. And they see no contradiction. They say, well, we have every right to be intolerant of you because you're a horrible hypocrite, you're evil, and, you know, and on it goes. But speaking lies in hypocrisy, nothing new. And tagged onto that, having their own conscience seared with a hot iron. We use a word in medical circles today, cauterize. To cauterize something. It speaks to burning the tissue so as to kill it. And it's usually used in connection when there's an infection, and the idea is we don't want the infectious tissue to spread further. So cauterize the wound, deaden it, so it's killed off. That's the Greek word that is referenced here. We get our English word cauterized from this Greek word here. And Paul uses it to describe one's conscience. Wow. We've talked about the conscience a lot when we were going through the book of Romans on Sunday and how God has given all a conscience. And isn't it true that even if you've never been born again Christian, but there is that general sense of right and wrong, even from your earliest days. And, you know, a young person thinks like, I can't do that. That'd be wrong to do. There's that guilt. There's that God-given conscience. But, of course, what happens if you go ahead and do it anyway, whether through peer pressure or just your desires overwhelm whatever your conscience is telling you, oh, how easy it is to do it the second time and the third time and the fourth time. And what you know was wrong at a young age in your older years, you can't wait till Friday and Saturday come so you can do it to the max. But there's another aspect to this being seared with a hot iron, because it is just the one word. And it was used in the sense of branding. If you think about it, when a rancher brands cattle, what's he doing? Searing with a hot iron. So if you look at it from a branding perspective, these false beliefs, these lies that are going forth, whose brand do they have? Not God's, but Satan's himself. Right on the conscience. To have Satan branded on your conscience That's not a good place to be. And so now we get a couple examples of what was going on in those days. Verse 3. Forbidding to marry. Now that's the first example, and then the second example. And commanding to abstain from foods which God created to be received with thanksgiving by those who believe and know the truth. For every creature of God is good, and nothing is to be refused if it's received with thanksgiving, for it is sanctified by the word of God and prayer. Now, these two issues seem to be prevalent in the early church. Paul, in his first letter to the Corinthians, writes a lot about both of these issues. First, the issue of forbidding to marry. The mindset seems to be that somehow if you really wanted to be spiritual, if you really wanted to be godly, then you would avoid any sort of sexual relations, which means you would even avoid marriage itself. And that was the idea. Forbidding to marry. And so Paul deals with that in great detail. He says, look, there's no doubt there are some people who have a gift of celibacy. And Jesus mentioned that as well. And such a person may be able to serve the Lord without the added responsibilities of spouse and children and so forth and family. But most people don't. And marriage is by all means to be preferred and sought. And like Paul says, you don't sin if you marry. That's ludicrous. But there were some in the early church forbidding to marry. Again, along that kind of mindset. Now, you fast forward a few centuries in church history. And what do we see? We see the established church saying that, well, it's okay for the regular Christians to get married, but if you want to be a leader in the church, you want to be a priest, someday be a bishop, maybe the pope, you cannot be married. Is that from the scripture? In fact, isn't the scripture saying the exact opposite? We forbid marriage. We were just reading about the qualifications for pastors and leaders in the church, and we saw the issue of husband. That doesn't mean you have to be married. But certainly there was no exclusion to having a wife. To see how things have really gotten far afield, today, that verse right there is used by the supporters of homosexual marriage against those in the church who would be opposed to homosexual marriage, saying that those opposed are violating God's word because we're forbidding to marry. Is that even remotely what God is saying here in the context? Not at all. The idea that Paul was telling Timothy that this was an issue is ludicrous. Now, along those lines, we have the issue of food. Food, likewise, was a big deal. There were these various convictions about, you know, as a Christian, can I eat this? Am I allowed to eat this and all? And there were issues that Paul gets into that involved the old pagan system as far as how meat was sacrificed to pagan gods before it was sold in the marketplace. There was also carryover, no doubt, from the Jewish dietary laws, where the early Christians who were from a Jewish background still had that issue. And of course, in Christ, there is neither Jew nor Gentile. So on the one hand, just like with choosing a life of singleness, certainly one can choose their diet. And a Jew who comes to Jesus Christ could still continue to eat kosher without any sort of problem. But the issue becomes when the commands, when the teaching going forth from the church is saying, if you're a Christian, you cannot eat these things. And Paul's saying that's just flat out wrong. No, that is just not what it is in Christ. And from the very earliest days of the church, it does seem that it was common for Christians to pray as a part of their meals and bringing God into it and thanking Him and all. And so, we ought to be clear, nowhere can we find in these verses instruction one way or another about, you know, how Christians ought to eat. You know, the whole idea, oh, body's the temple of God and you ought to eat this stuff and all that. That's not what's going on here at all. We all, I think, recognize common sense that a healthy diet is a wise thing. But that's not the issue here. So, you know, as a Christian, you can't, How can you be a Christian and be eating that Twinkie? Although, if we look at the ingredients of the Twinkie, it might be a stretch to say God has created it. It seems like most of it was created in a lab somewhere with a human means, but I digress. Now, as we move on to verse 6, sometimes it can be a little challenging reading a letter like this that is personal in many ways. Paul's writing to Timothy. You know, we're not Timothy. We're reading someone else's mail, as they say. But at the same time, we're reading God's word. My guess is that Paul wrote more than two letters to Timothy in his life. But there are two that are scripture. They are God-breathed. That means they are profitable for us, for instruction. And so, God wants us to seek the application in this letter to Timothy. And here we have a good opportunity. Because as Paul is talking to Timothy here in verse 6, there is an application to us. Because he speaks to Timothy as a servant. He uses the word minister in the New King James, but the idea is servant, not, you know, the pastor minister guy. Servant of Jesus Christ. Do you see yourself as a servant of Jesus Christ? Well, then these words are for us. So, verse 6. If you instruct the brethren in these things, you'll be a good minister or servant of Jesus Christ, nourished in the words of faith and of the good doctrine which you have carefully followed. So the words of faith, the good doctrine, and then the contrast, but reject the profane and the old wives' fables, he says. And exercise yourself toward godliness. That word exercise is in Greek where we get our word for gymnasium. Exercise yourself toward godliness. Make an effort, servant of Christ. Make an effort. And then we see the continuation of this thought. For bodily exercise profits a little, but godliness is profitable for all things, having promise of the life that now is and of that which is to come. This is a faithful saying and worthy of all acceptance. Now, verse 8 can be used by both sides of people who have an opinion on the whole issue of bodily exercise. You know, the couch potato says, look, the Bible says bodily exercise only profits a little, leave me alone. And then others will say, look, the Bible right there, the bodily exercise profits. Be involved in it. But once more, we ask the question, is that really the issue that God's word is trying to instruct us in? You know, the benefits of physical exercise. And the answer is no. There's a contrast taking place. Now, we do recognize, of course, again, sort of common sense, that exercise is a good thing for us. It is interesting that there doesn't seem to be a whole lot of additional benefits for a whole lot of additional exercise, that some moderate amount of exercise each week seems to get almost as much benefit as anything else. But the reality is, as you may have heard, we're all going to die. And we all realize, don't we? If you have a really active exercise life, it's not going to add 50, 100 years to your life. In fact, it can be argued if it'll add any years to your life. You know, we're all going to die on time. What, of course, it does benefit, we realize, is your quality of life. The years you have on this earth can certainly be much more productive, less painful, and so forth. And the Bible say that bodily exercise profits a little. I mean, there's no argument about that. We all recognize that. But that's not the point. 2,000 years ago when this letter was written, athletics was a big deal in society, just like today. Young men like Timothy were often very involved, dedicated to athletic training and bodily exercise. And here Paul is saying, you exercise, you make the effort towards godliness. That's where you devote your time. That's where your focus should be. Get the priorities right. Not 4 hours in the gym and 4 minutes in the Word, Timothy. Flip that around a little bit. You know, go to Jesus's gym, so to speak. Why? And here's where it's so obvious, and yet we need to hear it over and over again, and we do in the Bible in different places. Whatever benefits of bodily exercise, they are only for this life. But the benefits of exercising ourselves towards godliness not only are realized in this life, but also are realized in the life to come. That's the two ends of the scale. Where does it make the most sense to invest our lives in the thing that is just for this life, the temporal? Or to look at not only this life, but also the life to come. And that's an important point, because the Christian faith is not like, well, I got to trudge through this life and I'm really looking forward to heaven because that's where it's all going to be at. No, this life as well. Living a godly life has its benefits here and now. And as you've heard me say so many times, why does God call sin sin? The different sins in the Bible that he tells us to avoid, or the things that he commands us to do. Why? He's not just some killjoy. You know, all the unbelievers get to go have fun on the weekend. I'm a Christian. This stinks. It's because he knows that whatever he tells us to avoid is going to destroy us. It is hurtful to us, and often hurtful to other people as well. But it hurts us. Oh, it may be pleasurable for a season. And the Bible admits that. Sin is pleasurable for a season. But it destroys in the end. And God knows that. And God loves you. And he doesn't want you to do things that are destructive. Now, you're a moral agent. You can choose to disobey God even though he screams at you, don't do it. You still go out and do it. And you're going to reap what you sow. But you see, if we're thinking like, well, I just got to get through all this stuff on life just to get to heaven, and then, you know, reward will come there. No. The blessing is here and now. There's no greater blessing than to walk with the Lord in the fullness of the Spirit day by day. And then as the things of life in this fallen world hit us, whether it be bad health, financial problems, relationship problems, whatever it be, to be strong in the Lord when it hits you. Because as Jesus said, the storm's going to hit us. And our lives will either be on the shifting sand or built on the rock. But again, this life, and then the added bonus of the life to come. So to put all of our efforts towards the things that are just of this earth, and then before the Lord to watch like wood, hay, and stubble, it all just to vaporize in the fire. Or to be putting together gold, silver, precious stones that God refines, purifies, strengthens, and makes perfect. See, there's your eternity, my child. It's a no-brainer, isn't it? And that's what is being said. That's why bodily exercise is even brought into this discussion. We need to exercise towards godliness, and it's gonna take effort. Not to get saved, not to stay saved, but to grow in godliness. You all made an effort today. You got out of bed, you drove to church, you're here worshiping God, in the Word of God, fellowshipping with the saints. That'll have benefit to you the rest of the day and in the week to come. We will reap what we sow, whether we're sown to the Spirit or sown to the flesh. That is an absolute principle of God that no one can avoid. But God's love is what gives us the instruction for godly living. And the greatest act of love is seen at the cross. Because no matter how hard we may try, no matter how desirous our hearts may be, we've all sinned and come short of the glory of God. We all have rebelled against God one way or another, great or small, a few times or all the time. But God still loves us. His love is unconditional. And that love has been shown us there at the cross. And it is at the cross where Jesus died for you and me. Jesus, who is God in human flesh, who came, visited this earth for that primary purpose. Not to teach, not to do miracles, not to yell at Pharisees, but to come to die, to shed his blood, not for any sins or crimes of his own, but for your sins and mine. It's the greatest act of love in the history of the universe. Because he did that for sinners like you and I. But on the third day he rose from the dead. That sacrifice is complete, accepted, and available for every one of us who will just come and receive. And that's the truth. Say, well, that's what you believe. That's the truth. Oh, everyone can believe whatever they want, but you can't just make something false into something true just because you want it bad enough. I want a God after my own image. I want a God that... You can't do it. The truth is, we all need Jesus. The truth is, there is no salvation no other except Jesus. The truth is that every other religion, every other belief system, every other man-made philosophy is actually from the pit of hell. The truth is found in Christ. He's the one who died. He's the one who rose. He's the one who ascended into the heavens and is alive today, that each one of us can call to in prayer, Lord, save me, a sinner. And he will hear, and he will answer, yes, my child, you're forgiven. And then, moment by moment, day by day, we continue to call out, Lord, guide me today. Help me today. Strengthen me today. Comfort me today. Lord, I need you every hour. And he promises, my child, I will never leave you. I will never forsake you. I am with you always, even to the end of the age. That is the God that we serve. That is the God of the Bible. That is the truth about God.